Hi, I'm Mike Hutjens, Extension Dairy Specialist at the University of Illinois. This module will deal with forage feeding strategies on pasture-based feeding systems. Certainly, there are several advantages for using pasture and feeding high-producing dairy cows. First of all, it can be some very high-quality pasture, probably the highest quality you can get on a farm if managed correctly. Second, there are no harvest costs. The cow consumes the feed, and likewise, she also distributes the manure. So there's no handling concerns with manure on the farm, or at least during that time. Next, there's an improvement in cow comfort and feet and legs as the cow has more space, and of course, the ground is very forgiving. And finally, we may have some lower production costs, reducing our feed costs. If we review some of the studies done with economics, we go to Virginia, and there they report about a 23 to 72 cents more profit per cow per day versus a traditional TMR. Meanwhile, research from Pennsylvania and New York would suggest about a $182 higher income per year compared to conventional programs. Some Wisconsin studies would indicate a decrease in feed costs of about $167 per cow per day, lower veterinary costs, $136 per cow per day. Unfortunately, however, there's also about 14% less milk. But remember, these economics reflect that decrease in milk production as well. Of course, there are some disadvantages one must also consider on pasture-based feeding systems. First of all, the physically effective fiber, sometimes referred to as PE, NDF, is needed to maintain good rumen function. We basically use a value of about 50% for the effective NDF on pastures, and that's based on some New Zealand research. Compare that to baled hay, for example, that can exceed 92 to 96%. So certainly the physical fiber in terms of ruminant animal is important. New Zealand research secondly indicates that generally speaking, rumen pHs run under 5.5 because of its high quality, high rates of passage, and high digestibility rates. The crude protein content also can be very high. Pastures can vary as high as low as 17%, but as high as 32%. Well-managed pastures should always exceed about 25% with any amount of legume in the pasture, and about 65 to as high as 80% of that protein is rumen degradable, which means it breaks down to ammonia in the rumen and must be captured. Therefore, we must balance that carefully with carbohydrates to try to capture that ammonia as microbial protein without reducing rumen pHs any lower. And finally, dry matter intake can be limiting as cows can only consume so much pasture. Some of the management considerations on pasture intake are listed below. Generally speaking, cows will graze about 8 hours a day. That can range from 6 to 9 depending on pasture quality and environmental conditions, which means cows eat about 3 to 4 hours per session after milking. The average bite is about 60 to 65 bites per minute. This may be something you would like to monitor, can again reflects availability of pasture and pasture quality. It means these cows can consume about 2 kilograms or about 4.4 pounds of dry matter per hour if it's lush pasture. So you ask, well, how much pastures can they consume then? Certainly this is one way to see how much, or you can work it back using a Wisconsin guideline, is that cows will consume about 1.4% of their body weight as forage NDF, assuming that is the only forage source. Working with New Zealand workers, they suggest this number could be as high as 1.5. Let's do the math quickly. If I take a 1,300-pound Holstein cow using the decimal form of 1.4%, that ends up being about 18.2 pounds of forage NDF. If my NDF in my pasture is 40%, I then take the 18.2, divide that by 40% or decimal 0.4, and it says the most these cows consume is about 45 pounds of pasture dry matter. That's even a bit higher than using the 4.4 pounds per hour of pasture consumed. So basically you can see they can't eat enough pasture if they're really high producing cows. Therefore we suggest somewhere from 50 to 70% of the total ration dry matter coming from pastures to ensure adequate dry matter intake to support higher levels of milk production. Another way to evaluate ration success is look for signs of imbalance or shortages of nutrients. Here is a potential short list. First of all, cows rapidly drop in milk production after about 40 to 60 days after calving, indicates poor persistency, probably reflecting the loss of body weight and inability to consume enough nutrients to support the higher levels of milk production. Next, take a look at milk components and compare to breed averages. For example, Holstein cows should average around a 3.7 butterfat test and a true protein of 3% or total protein of 3.2%. If your milk is levels of components are less than that, may indicate a shortage of nutrients. Also look at fecal consistency. Cows that consume high levels of pasture may be very loose or having a fecal score of less than 2.5. Another sign of excess nitrogen loss will be the burning of grass. So if the cow urinates in the grass, coming back perhaps several days later, you will see these yellow burnt areas showing high levels of nitrogen excretion rather than being captured as microbial protein. Cows may also experience delay in estrus or low fertility because of a lack of energy, and of course thin cows or low body condition scores below a 2. So certainly one of your challenges on a pasture system is how do you make it more perfect in terms of cow performance and nutrient balance. First of all, generally speaking, the pasture can support somewhere around 50 to 60 pounds of milk energetically, which means that's how much dry matter she can consume. Therefore, if you have cows that produce higher levels of milk and milk with higher components, you will have to add concentrate or grain to this, and this will help meet energy requirements and perhaps performance on the cow as well. One of the real concerns about pasture is call substitution. This simply means that when a cow eats 1 pound more concentrate, that means she will eat about a half to two-thirds of a pound less pasture dry matter intake. Economically, this really concerns some dairy producers, especially when you get in New Zealand. But remember, not only have you substituted that, you've also increased the total dry matter intake by a quarter to 4/10 to a half a pound of dry matter intake. So certainly, it's kind of a win-win, especially when grains are modestly priced like here in the U.S. So if a producer or manager is going to feed more grain to their dairy cows, here are some guidelines and some nutrient sources to consider. Number one, the guideline for Penn State indicates about 1 pound of additional grain for every 4 to 5 pounds of milk after the pasture nutrient supply has become limiting. So for Holsteins, that's probably somewhere around 50 pounds of milk and around 30, 35 pounds of milk for Jerseys. Next, limit the amount of grain per feeding to 5 or 6 pounds per day. That's to avoid slug feeding and rumen acidosis. Next, look at the rate of starch and fiber degradability. For example, wheat or barley breaks down much quicker than corn grain, and coarser ground corn breaks down slower than finely ground corn. So trying to match these rates would certainly improve microbial protein yield and ammonia capture. Feeding rumen inert fats can sometimes increase energy intake, especially in the summer under heat stress. This will increase your feed costs, but they do not affect the rumen fiber digestion capability of the rumen. Next, we look at rumen undegraded protein, or RUP. These responses are positive if and when amino acids are first limiting. And for Holstein cows, this is probably in that 60-65 pound range. Don't feed protein as an energy source. And believe it or not, you may also need to check from time to time soluble protein levels, especially if you're feeding corn silage. Even though you have lots of degradable and lots of crude protein in the diet, it may not be there quick enough. You may need a little bit of urea in certain feeding programs. Perhaps a few guidelines on how and when to feed grain might be useful. In this chart, we look at when and how much supplemental grain should you be feeding to Holstein cattle. If your target level of milk production is under 13,000 pounds of milk, high-quality pasture should get the job done. However, if you're trying to maintain in the range of 17,000 to 18,000 pounds of milk, then a ratio of about 80% pasture and 20% supplemental feeds would be encouraged. If you, in fact, have genetically high-producing cows and you want to try to maintain that production and reproductive performance, then perhaps something like 65% pasture and 35% supplemental feeds would be appropriate. Obviously, as we get higher milk production levels, we are going to have to provide supplemental nutrients to maintain that level of milk yield on your farm. So let's look at some of these supplemental choices you may be part of that 20, 30, 40% of total ration dry matter. One choice could be hay. Could be a legume or a grass-sourced feed on the farm. Hay would provide both a source of nutrients, in this case certainly more protein and some energy, and of course an excellent source of physically effective NDF, meaning cud-chewing effects. A second forage choice could be straw. Realizing there is not many nutrients there, but it can form the forage mat, slow things down, and be an excellent source of physically effective NDF. Very common in New Zealand would be small grain forages. These would be like wheat silage, oat silage, or barley silage. They provide alternate forage source, can be a source to be used to establish the pasture as a cover crop, or in some countries, a double crop system here. Again, if it's chopped properly, a good source of physically effective NDF. Maize silage or corn silage is my first choice. I think it's an excellent product, primarily because it balances out the protein nutrient profile and increases dry matter intake, and also being a very palatable product. In some areas, we will find turnips or swedes, which can be used to extend pasture dry matter intake, especially in cool seasons or in winter time periods when the cow can utilize these as a forage source. When we look at long forages, especially when we process silages, we define long forage. Cud chewing material is some particle size of 3/4 inch, which is about 18 millimeters or longer. This causes the cow to cud chew and to form the forage mat in the rumen. When this is there, cows should spend about 550 to 600 minutes a day of cud chewing per cow per day, reducing feed particle size and producing sodium bicarb. We generally recommend adding 2 to 4 pounds on a pasture-based system to complement the pasture sources of NDF as well. Ideally, if I could feed this about 30 minutes to 1 hour before getting grain in the parlor or before going to pasture would be a plus, because it sets up the forage mat and changes the dynamics in the rumen. Another choice for many farmers, especially in Illinois and the Midwest, would be byproduct feeds because they are very economical. Such things as soy hulls, corn gluten feed, wheat mids, and in some areas in the Midwest would be beet pulp. We can look at this as a source of digestible fiber so that we don't have to load the cow up with more starch or sugar, which could affect rumen acidosis. Generally speaking, adding 3 to 5 pounds per cow per day would be an alternative choice on pasture-based systems. So for example, we could feed them 5 pounds of shell corn and 5 pounds of soy hulls mixed together to reduce the starch load. This may improve rumen fermentation by maintaining the rumen pH closer to 6 and also produces more acetic acid, which is important for butterfat, not the propionic acid, which would be derived from sugars and starches and could lead to even lower rumen pHs. And now let's look at my favorite forage, corn silage. The beauty of corn silage, and becoming much more popular in New Zealand as well, is not only is it a source of forage, but also an excellent source of starch. Starch is one of the key ingredients to stimulate rumen fermentability in the rumen and capture that extra ammonia. The other neat thing about corn silage, it is very low in crude protein. So I can complement that 25 to 30% protein coming from pasture with a product that can be as low as 6 to 8% crude protein. Next, it should enhance dry matter intake because first, it's very palatable, and second of all, it will have a faster rate of breakdown in the rumen and allow for more total dry matter to occur in the cow. Remember, we have various choices when it comes to corn silages in terms of variety choices and other alternatives on how we deliver that feed to the cow. So let's summarize this module with several take-home messages. Number one, well-managed pastures can be an excellent forage source on the farm and, of course, can be very economical at the same time, improving cow comfort and health. Next, we know pasture is not nutritionally balanced, so work with your feed company or nutritionist or consultant to try to make it a more balanced feeding program depending on the level of milk production. Finally, generally speaking, supplemental nutrients are going to be needed for those cows producing more than 50 pounds of milk from Holsteins, or perhaps 35 or 40 pounds of milk from Jerseys. These nutrient sources could come from forages, concentrates, or byproduct feeds. Well, that completes this module. Thanks. Have a great day.